Hello and welcome to the Genuine Learning Blog. My name is Melisa Galasso, and today we're going to talk about a proposed change to the peer review standards. There are two key areas that they're focusing on. One is related to quality management. Obviously, the SQMSs have a change to all the firms who have accounting and auditing practices, and so they want to incorporate some changes into peer review, and also what they consider to be omnibus changes, other changes that need to be addressed. So this was issued on November 16th, and it is going to be a series of changes. Now, obviously, as we go through this, we're going to hit the highlights, the ones that they have identified as some of the more popular, larger changes, and we're focusing on the ones that are changing the rules. There's a lot of application guidance change, but we're going to focus on the actual requirements changes for today, and there are obviously conforming amendments throughout. So what are they proposing to do? Well, they are proposing on the quality management side to obviously revise several paragraphs for consistency with the objectives established for quality management. So from quality control to quality management, obviously we have some changes that need to be incorporated throughout the peer review guidance, and so they're going to make those changes. It's also going to require peer reviewers to submit completed quality management checklists as part of the documents that need to be submitted, and so this is not surprising here. As we have these changes, this is something that they would want to make sure they're taking a look at. And then they are making a clarification. Now, I thought it was interesting that this is actually listed as QM finding because of the verbiage that is in quality management. And so it clarifies that the definition of a finding in a system review is one or more related matters that result in the same systemic cause. And so root cause analysis is really important in the new quality management standards. And so that's going to be a key change there. And then it's going to also require the technical reviewer to include a review in those system reviewers to include the review of quality management checklists and any explanation of no answers. And so this is really a focus for making sure as we switch to these new QM standards that we have an opportunity to ensure that they're being applied consistently. But outside of the quality management changes, there are other changes that are going to be in here. And as you probably have heard, we have a little bit of a pipeline issue. We have not enough people to do all the work that we need. And this is very acutely aware in the peer review world. At one point, this is several years ago, because I was still in public accounting at the time, but there was an estimate that the average age of a peer reviewer was somewhere in their 60s. And so obviously people who retire are going to have problems here. And so this is going to provide a transition period for reviewers that retire from practicing public accounting so that they can continue to serve as team members for transition purposes. So traditionally, you have to be obviously actively working in this area. I can't serve as a peer reviewer because I don't do any audits, right? So for our training perspective, while I'm very familiar with the standards, I'm not eligible to be a peer reviewer because it's supposed to be a peer, someone who does the same work as you. And so this would allow a little bit of a transition period. It's also going to extend the period of time from 12 months to 18 months for certain reviewer training to be taken before commencement of a review. And so again, this is to provide flexibility. We all know that there are crunch periods, and this would allow a little bit more flexibility there. It also is going to require peer reviewers to submit any completed alternative practice structure checklists as part of the documents required to be submitted to administering entities. And again, we are seeing more private equity and more alternative practice structures pop up. And so I think this is something, I know PEAK has a project on it, and obviously peer review has an interest in this as well. And then in terms of, as we go through this, it introduces a new paragraph to prompt a reviewer to consider for out-of-state licensure purposes, whether one or more of its state boards of accountancy require its peer review results to be provided through the facilitated state board access. And so obviously if you have multiple states, reciprocity, mobility, all the things that we talk about every time we go to council, the FSBA is required by some states, and so you have to make that evaluation. And then it introduces new application and other explanatory material paragraph that provides an example of an appropriate engagement selection in engagement reviews. And so there's going to be some requirements that come out of that, that guidance there. And then it removes prior review implementation plan letters from the list of required documents to be provided in the RAB materials. So last but not least, obviously, they don't want to have to list every time they change the word quality control to quality management throughout the entire document. So there would just be conforming revisions. This is something similar to what we saw with Yellow Book. Yellow Book said, I'm going to edit chapter 5 and make it right, but I'm going to also have to change all the other chapters, but we're not going to put those out for proposal. It's going to be a find, copy, replace, right? So we're going to move to a quality management throughout the entire document. So the proposed effective dates align, as you can imagine, with quality management. So for the quality management related items, it would be for peer review ends on or after December 31st of 2025, which again aligns with the 2025 deadline to have your system of quality management up and running. And then for those omnibus ones not related to quality management, it would be for peer reviews commencing on or after October 31st of 2024. And so again, when we take a look at this, those are not related to quality management, so they don't have to be tied to the same effective date. They gave a very long time for us to provide comments because they recognize they issued this in November, right before the holidays. And then as we go through this, we're going to get into the holidays and then quickly into busy season. So comments are due May 31st of 2024 to allow everybody the opportunity to read through the entire document and provide feedback to the AICPA. So you got a little bit of time. I definitely want to take a closer look at it. All right, so that's a wrap this week on the Genuine Learning Blog. Hopefully, if you are either peer-reviewed or you are a peer reviewer, you will take a closer look at this and give some feedback to the AICPA on if they missed anything, if there's some changes that you would you have concerns with, definitely let them know. So thank you guys so much for joining me, and I hope to see you on a future blog. Have a great day, guys. Bye-bye.